and see if you like the statements.
How about the artist reading the statement out loud?
Oh, I suppose I could spoil it. Artist statement. True open seriousness fears neither parody nor irony, nor any other form of reduced laughter, for it is aware of being part of an uncompleted whole. Mikhail Bakhtin. This exhibition exposes the relationship between carnival parody and social criticism through images of stereotype and cliché. These artworks take their cue from the satirical artifice of grotesque folk humour, which can be traced back beyond Rabelais to the dawn of civilization. Their objective is to confront and reevaluate concepts of the self and the corruption of consciousness. There is a part of all of us in each of us. Therefore, one portrays the universal we when one portrays the universal me. I am other.
Very nice.
You think that sounds all right? It's not too, I don't want to put too much wind back in. I think that's quite enough, actually. Quite enough wind back. The Martyr and His Fool. Satan, sin, and death. Well, Satan, sin, and death, and the what's the insulation's got, these go together, I know it's bizarre with the numbering of 3 next to 21, but there it is. Scarlet Angels. Number 23, The Anguish of St. Raymond. The episode from St. Mark 14, 66 to 72, in which Peter, soon after Christ's arrest, is challenged by the serving maid of Caiaphas, the high priest, to admit his identity as one of Christ's disciples was not often depicted during the Counter-Reformation, and the subject's dramatic possibilities clearly appealed less to the artist than the cloying sentimentality of the penitent St. Peter. Opposite, we find another representation of a penitent, the benighted St. Raymond, celebrated from a more recent epoch that perfectly accords a poem titled Shadow Man, penned by the saint himself shortly before his untimely demise. Shadow Man. Who am I? Do I still know me? Am I not shadow of my former self? I, who have cultivated survival, I, who have rationalized my existence, I, who have repressed my intuitive self, I, who have said, but that's the way of the world. I, who have adopted the expectations of others so often, I only think I know who I am. I have lost my imperial self. I have become an actor, a pseudo-self, a mimic of a character that I once knew. A shuck of a husk, a Hegelian shell of a shadow of that man I once.
Have you come from outside Southampton?
No, I'm just...
You just haven't seen Ray for quite some time.
I've been to him occasionally, but I've never seen his work.
Oh, did you? This is his latest stuff, his earlier stuff. You've seen his etchings as well.
I heard somebody talk about it. His wife was saying...
Right.
You've
seen one on this wall, the first one?
Yeah.
That is the print of an etching. And his earlier stuff is very much like the stuff on this wall here. Both of those actually are printed etchings. But the latest stuff, this is the digital stuff, this is the stuff that's doing that.
Digital, right. That's the word,
Yeah, he's got, he actually works with someone who's, obviously didn't want to be named tonight, but he was doing, his friend does a lot of work. Digitizing the photographs on the computer.
Crystal theory. And how much
the menu. No, she'll like it. She will like it.
I'm digital. That's what we're trying to sort of work out. But maybe the kind of thing that
she likes stuff that she has to figure out.
Well, it's creative industry in that day. We're producing something new for it. Nothing
else. I've been working on it.
And
the DRG is nothing but props.
Things that need crystal theory, well, if I not exists within a framework of crystal theory. Something exists within a framework of crystal theory.
If you want.
No, that's fine.
Number two, forbidden fruit. Such a regrettable state of affairs have also exacerbated a poignant saga of middle-aged remorse, and find our postmodern prodigal disastrously cloned as a few pounds of forbidden fruit. Meddling bystanders have even dared suggest that this is the result of a profligate lifetime spent foaming as a raving mystic. Now I have it, an uncommonly good authority, that the malcontent in question did see himself as a dilettante, dissident and vagrant scholar, prone to passionate philosophical discourses on free love and the cynics. But even so, maligned as a raving mystic. However, I digress, while all this semantic quibbling still does not erase this fraught vision of apathetic concupiscence from before your eyes. What is most disheartening is the way the forbidden has been flippantly discarded to the sod by the mother and father of all living, only to become just one among many fallers. It seems that Satan has wasted his efforts as nobody is devouring these tantalizing spectres of fruit. Despite the forbidden one's best endeavours to look hot and beguiling. Once again, Adam and Eve managed to escape all these alluring temptations, only to succumb another day on the new moon of the fourth month of the eighth year after creation. Jubilees 3, line 33. Meanwhile, the forbidden is irrelevantly cast out of his garden of earthly delights by a thwarted and embittered sun.
Well,
no, I was going to say, right?
Yeah.
Are you camera shy? Are you camera shy? That's all right, then. Don't upset anyone.
Nevertheless, most know that devotion to a discipline does not necessarily preserve a man from ignorance, selfishness, vice, and absurdity. History is full of examples of that, and folklore has presented us the literary figure of Dr. Faustus to symbolise this danger. Naively, this latter-day Constantine Guise failed to appreciate that high society portraiture has its diabolus, that it could aspire to unwitting self-advancement, to hollow kudos, to artistic vanity, and eventually to the flagrant pursuit of power and then the abuse of that power. However, when the sweet taste of influence and success finally lost its savour, a self-loathing appeared with the realization of a once true life sacrificed on the altar of shallow folly, of a career superficially rewarded but damned by the lack of any lasting contentment and spiritual growth. For now he understood that he had become no more than a member of the highest echelons of artistic pomposity, clinging to an odious and obscure clique of daubers, reassuring status for an affluent elite. He was a gifted but cosseted talent, lacking any feeling for reality. An arrogant and Baudelairean dandy who had made a frivolous pursuit and empty self-indulgence his vocation and the essence of his truckling existence. Finally, he wanted nothing more than to wallow seditiously with other misfits, wanted no other life than the world's life, its crude, passionate, naive, unregulated existence, oscillating habitually between bravado and dread. He drank the strongest spirits, availed himself of every trance-inducing narcotic, fraternized with the most depraved of wenches, while simultaneously deriding decency, reverence, and all things spiritual. Let that be a warning to you. Pompous blather, wasn't it? It's endless pompous blather.
Foolish.
Yeah.
Yeah.
Yeah.